By now, I hope that those of you who have been attending these lectures will know what to say when somebody says, "Do you believe in climate change?" What would you say?
Yes.
No, I don't believe in it. I know it because the science is there. It's not a matter of belief. This is not religion. This is science. So, but I appreciate the good turnout. We're pleased to see so many people from the outside as well as the CERC community coming in here. And when I say outside, I really mean from the CERC surrounding community. So that's great that you're here. Remember that this is the fourth. There's two more lectures after this, also on Tuesdays for the next two Tuesdays coming at the same time, same place. And we hope you'll come to each of those. The lectures are being videotaped and are being put on links, YouTube links for our website. As Kristen gets a chance to edit them and incorporate the slides and the animation links and other things into that, you can look online and go back and visit them, or if you miss one of the lectures, you can see it. Or if you want to tell somebody about it, you can have them look at it as well. After the lecture, Bert will be happy to answer some questions with you, for you. So keep coming back and keep your good thoughts going. So without further ado, Bert's going to talk on the fourth of his series on the science of climate change. Thanks, Bert.
Thank you, Chuck, and thank you for all of you for coming back. I know if I work at it, I can wear you down. I just wanted to mention that this lecture is about plants and about what we might expect from them in the future and what we can't expect. And it's about food security. The next lecture will be on controlling carbon dioxide. And the final lecture will be about, it'll be a summary of the whole course, but it'll also be about deniers and the question of uncertainty. The last lecture will be focused on a book by Naomi Oreskes. At the end of this talk, I'll show a picture of the book in case you'd like to have a look at it, because it seems to me we could have a discussion about what she talks about in her book. So with that, today we want to talk about carbon dioxide, plants, and food. Maybe you've noticed, but carbon dioxide is the theme here. It runs through everything, and it's because, to remind you, it's what's causing the warming. And without taking care of carbon dioxide, we can't do anything about the warming. That's what I'll talk about next week. But carbon dioxide has a direct effect on plants. As I mentioned last week in the talk about the origins of the Anthropocene, as you remember, I said that it's my idea and others, I didn't invent it, that the rapid rise in carbon dioxide at the end of the last ice age stimulated the production of plants so much on land that people could settle down just by harvesting wild plants. The type example for that is what happened in the Middle East, in the Zagros Mountains that runs through what's called the Fertile Crescent. The reason I mention the mountains is because plant ripening goes gradually up the mountainside, and the theory is that people found that they could harvest enough during the ripening season to settle and stay until the next year and then plant plants. How they got to domestication is a more difficult question. They obviously bumped into it, they didn't intend it, but that was a very important part of carbon dioxide. And since then, agriculture has been the basis of civilization. And agriculture has contributed a large fraction of the total amount of carbon dioxide that we've put up in the atmosphere. First of all, by cutting trees down. And secondly, when we began to burn fossil fuels and we could do agriculture big time, just from burning fossil fuels and everything that goes with agriculture. So agriculture is a really important part. And we'll get to the question of the food supply because it seems to be threatened by climate change. But first of all, I would like to approach the question of how much of the CO2 that we put up into the atmosphere might we expect the plants to absorb? Because this was the question that informed the origins of this study. At the beginning of the work that I did here, there were several people who were interested in trying to estimate what the plants on Earth could possibly do. The first question was, will they actually take up more carbon dioxide when you raise the CO2? And it was a good question because laboratory studies had shown that if you grow plants in high CO2, they adjust, and they adjust downward. We called it acclimation or down-regulation. We didn't realize at the time that it wasn't simply regulating the enzymes of photosynthesis. It was responding to the fact that the plants in high CO2 take up less nitrogen. That whole story has emerged later. We saw it in our data, and like everybody else, we looked at it and didn't pay much attention to the fact that it was always associated with water loss from the plants. Eventually, somebody got around to putting those things together, and that seems to be the explanation. So we'll get into that a little bit. So the question of carbon dioxide going on land, we first have to think about the partition of the CO2 we put up here. This name means man-made. Man-made emissions into sinks. We use the term sinks to think of the ocean as a place for carbon dioxide to go, but it also goes into the atmosphere and the land. The ocean takes up about 44% of the carbon dioxide that we put in the, the atmosphere absorbs about 44% of the carbon dioxide we put up there. We put it up, Somebody's listening to this and they don't like what I'm saying. Uh, 44% of the emissions remain and accumulate in the atmosphere. The term accumulate is appropriate because carbon dioxide remains in the atmosphere for a very long time. And as a matter of fact, if you could, there's two seats right down here, folks. You found a couple there, okay. If you take the carbon dioxide, for example, that comes out of your car is a big source of carbon dioxide. Most cars that get an average of 20 miles per gallon, if you drive a big car, you get about 20 miles per gallon. 20 miles per gallon will produce 1 pound of carbon dioxide per mile. 1 pound per mile. This is a rule of thumb you can remember. A pound of carbon dioxide is pretty heavy, but it looks like a really big orange. That carbon dioxide will trap 10,000 times as much heat while it's in the atmosphere as was released in your engine when it was produced. So think of the energy that was produced when you emitted a pound of carbon dioxide out the back of your car to get your car a mile. 10,000 times that is the amount of infrared energy will be trapped by that unit of carbon dioxide. So it stays up there and it's very effective. But about a quarter of the carbon dioxide is taken up by the oceans. This is done, this estimate is made by modeling. The oceanographers say that the movement of carbon dioxide into the ocean is all but a physical process. It's a little bit dependent on biology because if there are things growing in the ocean, as there are near the land, they can take up some of the carbon dioxide. But it's primarily a physical process, and so it can be calculated. Well, you add up these two, and what's left over is what we think goes on the land. So this is a collective of all the errors and so forth in these estimates, but the number is more or less repeatable. There's an organization called the globalcarbonproject.org that keeps track of this. They have a group of people there in Australia at CSIRO, and they have dedicated a great deal of money to trying to figure out how much carbon dioxide is emitted, where it goes, and all the details. So the land takes up a third, approximately, of the carbon dioxide that we put up into the atmosphere. Now that's significant. And so the question becomes, how significant is it? And we have to put it in the context of what the plants are actually doing. So now here's a cartoon, and it's showing you that there is a lot of carbon dioxide underground in fossil fuels. The term here, gigaton fuel, if you read the literature, you'll see this number as PG for petagrams, and it'll be bigger than that. I don't like the term petagrams. It sounds like something that your cat ate. But gigatons has gravitas. I like that. It's appropriate to the question here. About greater than 18,000, this is an estimate. And of course, the question is, can we actually get it all? It's not clear. The land plants and soil contain about 10,000 gigatons, and the atmosphere contains about 2,600 gigatons. We are taking carbon dioxide out of the ground at the rate of about 34 gigatons per year. But the plants are absorbing 450 gigatons per year, approximately. Now, nobody goes out with their little CO2 device and measures this. This is all done by estimates. As far as we know, photosynthesis takes up something of the order of 450. And then respiration, that is the part of those curves of CO2 that's going back up in the fall, releases about 439. Now the difference between two really big numbers is what the land takes up. Somewhere in the vicinity of 10 gigatons per year. It varies from year to year, but it's been consistent since these guys have been trying to keep track of these things. So the point is, these two processes are biological processes, and they are affected tremendously by things like the amount of solar radiation, that's photosynthesis, the temperature, that's respiration. Respiration is a huge process. And when we began to think about how much carbon was going on the land, many people thought that if the temperature of the soil goes up 1 degree, it will increase this big number by 10%. This is enormous. It turns out it's not quite true. In other words, we didn't know enough about respiration, and we probably still don't, to make really good guesses about what's going to happen in the future. The take-home lesson from this figure is that when you talk about the carbon budget of plants on the land, you're talking about processes that deal with enormous amounts of carbon dioxide every year. So that small changes in our environment or the carbon dioxide can have big effects. So if photosynthesis here increases 1%, that's 45 gigatons. That outstrips the number up there 11 by a whole lot. A lot of people have concluded that as long as the CO2 is rising and everything else is equal, like maybe the temperature doesn't go up too far, then the land plants can continue to take up carbon dioxide. But we're doing a lot to discourage them. Here is the CO2 curve, just to remind us that that's what this is all about. And we have the way plants do photosynthesis, carbon dioxide coming in through these little holes, and this carbon reduction process going on here. And here is our photosynthesis curve. Turns out that this is a pretty good description of the way things work in the field. Not exactly, because photosynthesis is modified and shaped by the environment. But the point is that when we started our work on carbon dioxide here at CERN, the level was right about here. Now, we're thinking about it going up to about where that red mark is by the end of the century. That's up to about double where it was. What it's actually going to be at the end of the century, we don't know. And the reason is we don't know enough about what's going on the land to make a prediction. If the guys who study atmospheric physics and chemistry predict what the temperature is going to be in the future, they think they can do it pretty well if you tell them what the CO2 concentration in the atmosphere is going to be at any given time. But if you try to model all these processes on land and then estimate what the CO2 will be in the future, the range of uncertainty is so high that it's more than double the range of uncertainty for what the physical guys can do. So what happens on land is really important. And while I didn't know all that when I started out, I just had the idea that plants like CO2, let's go out to Mars and see what happens. So, but that's the concept behind why we should, why the Department of Energy, which was tasked with studying the role of energy use in our environment. What are the effects of using fossil fuels, energy of any kind, in fact, on our environment? They were the ones who supplied all the money that we started out with, and I think they may still be giving us some money, but we had money from them for at least 20, 25 years. I'll remind you again that plants growing in high CO2 for the same time, these are soybean plants, and they're growing for a little less than 3 weeks. This one is growing at where we think the CO2 is going to be at the end of the century, and these are growing at where it was when we started our work. Nobody born from now on will ever see that level of CO2 again in our atmosphere, I believe. This plant has a lot more leaves than that one, and it's fixing nitrogen and has more nitrogen fixation going on here. So high CO2 does stimulate plant growth, and we demonstrated that in the field. There's the 19 or 20 year record of measuring the net ecosystem production, that is the uptake of carbon dioxide by photosynthesis minus the loss of carbon dioxide by respiration from the marsh. And the average was about 35% over the course of this experiment. As I mentioned, shaped by the environment, on dry years, not very much happened. You wouldn't think that would be the case, because in the marsh, their feet are wet most of the time. But nevertheless, that's what we found. And the average annual increase was about 35%. There have been about 50 studies like this, or enough like this, that the data could be reviewed, and it was reviewed by Ichi Lo, who's much smarter than his name sounds. And in a paper with others he produced called Elevated CO2 Stimulates Net Accumulation of Carbon and Nitrogen in Land Ecosystems, and this is the basic take-home lesson. And it shows that for both carbon and nitrogen, plants grown in high CO2, the majority of them have a big response to the CO2. Or in other words, something between 0 and a 10% increase. So as I mentioned before, a 1% increase in photosynthesis worldwide would give an uptake of carbon that's much bigger than it is now, big enough to make a big surplus. So you don't have to imagine the plants taking up very much more to take up some of what we take. Remember what we're putting up there. Remember, we're putting up about 34, 35 gigatons of CO2 per year. So if the plants could take up 1% more, I pointed out that was 45 gigatons more than all the photosynthesis being taken up now. So potentially this would be a very effective thing. It's a little bit difficult to go from a salt marsh and persuade anybody that knows half a thing about ecology that's going to solve our problem for us. That what we found out there in that marsh probably isn't enough. We need a lot more than that. 50 studies around the world and the figure I just showed you are not enough. We need something bigger than that. We'd like to know if we could measure CO2 uptake or growth of plants. And right on cue comes this paper, Greening of the Earth and Its Drivers. This was published about a year ago in April of 2016. And the paper has lots and lots of names on it. You'll see many people from China there. What's happening here is that people are looking at the record of the satellites for the period from about 1982 up until 2010. It's still going on, but the record that they evaluated stops in 2010 or 2014. The three lines, the red, the blue, and the green, are different records from the satellites. The red and the blue cloud around them represent something about the uncertainty around those numbers. But what's really interesting in this record is that the clouded lines here, these vertical lines, are representing El Niños. They have numbers on them, so apparently they don't name El Niños, they put numbers on them. And you'll notice that wherever there was an El Nino, the numbers tend to go down. Numbers going up mean the Earth's getting greener. Numbers going down mean it's getting browner or less green. So here's an El Nino right here, and the numbers take a nosedive. When the El Nino goes away, they come up again. And then they start back down again because right here, Mount Pinatubo blew up. And what volcanoes tend to do is they tend to put dust up in the atmosphere, which is like a sunscreen. It shuts down the solar radiation. And that's enough to cool the Earth so that respiration declines a bit, but also to back photosynthesis off a little bit. And so it goes. But the record is upward. And they did more than just take this record. They had other things in mind. So they looked at the various parts of the Earth. That's what the satellites can do. And they can tell you with considerable precision something about the greenness. This number, LAI, means leaf area index. If you have a big old tomato plant that's about like this, and you counted all the leaves and measured their area over the area that their shadow subtends, the leaf area index would be 1 if all the leaves added together would equal the area underneath that plant. So the numbers here go up to greater than 25, so you can imagine what that's got to be, a jungle or something like that, where the column of leaves is tall and there are leaves everywhere. And the different numbers show you where you can look. But the paper said that the greening was especially notable in the southeastern United States. That's a wet part of the United States, and it's getting wetter. In the Amazon basin, the numbers there are really huge. In Europe, in Central Africa, and in Southeast Asia, all these places show that over this period of time, they're getting greener. So the question becomes, why? And the modelers got busy because they have some idea now about what plants can do with extra carbon dioxide, because they've seen all these studies that have been done. And so they parameterized their models with some of that data, but also with data from climate change, temperature, for example. We know a little bit about what temperature does to plants. The two things that explain most of the distribution of plants on Earth are temperature and water. Above 40 degrees latitude, it's mostly temperature. Below 40 degrees, it's mostly water. So that was that one there, it's got that color. And NDE means nitrogen distribution. We're pumping a lot of nitrogen into the atmosphere, so you'd expect that it would promote growth. Well, let's see, there is the greenness, that's the carbon dioxide. Now, all three of these things had an effect, but carbon dioxide accounted for 70% of the effect of the increase in leaf area across the Earth during the time these satellites were making their measurements. The climate part was 8%, and nitrogen only 4%. Now, this is a nice confirmation that the idea that rising CO2 would stimulate green plant growth on Earth. It doesn't tell us, however, how much extra carbon they're putting up there and how much is staying behind, because they can only see the leaves. So some kind of magic has to happen between more leaves and more carbon. And I haven't seen that estimate yet, but I'm sure somebody's going to come up with it sooner or later. So this is the model that I think we would run from our results out on the marsh. If you were asked me the question, what will the Earth do with extra carbon dioxide? Well, it'll really grow. But like those other guys who are selling stuff like I'm doing, the favorite phrase is, but wait, there's more. And the thing you have to keep in mind is that something else is happening with the carbon dioxide, namely the temperature is going up. And then climate change, whatever that means. And it means a lot of things, but the temperature really means something. So the temperature is going up. And not only that, but the Earth is drying out in certain places. Here is the drying of North America, decades-long mega drought. And now here's the scale down here. Soil moisture at down to 30 centimeters, -3, whatever the units are, or +3. So the color code shows you on the Earth, but here we are at 2023 with an increase in temperature of 1.25 centigrade. And then if we go up to 2 degrees centigrade increase, the changes get more brown. And finally, if we get up to 4.3 degrees at the end of the century, these guys predict that drought is increasing dramatically. If the general rule is that the dry places on Earth are getting drier and the wet places are getting wetter. And of course, that's pretty grand scale. The precipitation predictions are much more difficult than the temperature predictions, and so there are large uncertainties around it. But this is the general belief of folks who study the climate and drought, that drought is going to become a permanent thing for us. And of course, that has a big effect on plants. Now the question of why we can't just take my model of the Earth with all the trees growing out of it and be satisfied with it is that the climate change is having much different effects on different parts of the Earth that directly affect the carbon budget that I showed you to begin with. One of them is, as we looked at in the first talk, that the Arctic is warming faster than any place else. And what that means is that the snow is going away sooner, and the soil is not only thawing out, it's drying out. There are now forest fires in the Arctic tundra. Arctic tundra is about that big, and so a forest fire up there isn't quite the same thing as it is in the sequoia forest. But forest fires are now something new in the Arctic that haven't occurred in man's memory. So it's really warming up. But the really big part is that northern ecosystems, including these forests here, this is a Mercator projection, so it's not really quite comparable, but the point is that in Russia and over here in northern Canada, those forests are experiencing forest fires, so carbon is coming out of the forest that way. But more importantly, offshore, the ice has gone away, and the shallow waters off Russia and off Canada are beginning to bubble up methane. How much methane comes out is not clear. It's being studied, but I haven't seen any sort of rule of thumbs that would allow you to make grand statements like, you know, so many gigatons per year. Methane is a more important greenhouse gas that is more effective on a unit basis than is carbon dioxide, but it only lasts a little while in the atmosphere. Carbon dioxide lasts up to 100 years in the atmosphere, as I mentioned earlier. So methane could become a really important problem in the future because the Arctic is warming up and the carbon that's there is going to go out. Well, of course, if it's warming up, the plants that are there are going to take up more carbon dioxide because they get more carbon dioxide to stimulate photosynthesis. And so far, not enough work has been done to draw the balance exactly. But everybody's worried. The next place that I'd like to point out shows some real difficulty is the tropical rainforest. The tropical rainforest takes up something like 50 or more percent of the carbon dioxide that's absorbed by plants on an annual basis because it's really warm, it's really wet, and there's lots of plants there to take it up. But the tropical rainforest exists at a very narrow temperature range, something like 26, 27 degrees centigrade, and it hardly varies from day to night, just a little bit. The question is, what if the temperature goes up several degrees where the tropical rainforest is? Will that slow down their capacity to take carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere? Now you see what I'm suggesting, that one part of the globe is going to start pumping out carbon dioxide, and another part may have its capacity to take carbon dioxide out challenged. So there is considerable concern about what's going on the Earth as far as the plants are concerned, and we definitely don't know enough about it yet to make precise predictions. All right, now I want to move on to food, and I'd like to point out a book that is an excellent summary of what we're faced with and where we stand now. The writer is Joel Bourne. His name, he's a writer for National Geographic. He's a very good writer. This book is available in Kindle format. I was reading it at about 4 o'clock this morning again, and learning all about Ukraine. Ukraine produces enormous amounts of wheat. It doesn't now, because the political system has more or less destroyed the agricultural system. And what's happened is that big investors from around the world have come in to buy up the land, or to lease the land. They can't buy it yet. Sometime in the future they'll be able to, but they can't yet. So what's going to happen is that these guys are producing crops. They're trying to teach the locals how to do it. This fellow describes the difficulties that you have culturally to pick up all the modern methods. So the end of plenty talks about that. It also talks about the importance of aquaculture. It's a fascinating read, but it presents a very dismal view. It says we're basically back where we were in the 50s when Norman Borlaug started. And Borlaug thought he provided only a 30-year relief from famine. And he tells you why. The first chapter in the book is about Malthus. Malthus talks about the relationship between dinner and sex, or the food supply and the birth rate. We're different. he says that increasing human population, here goes Malthus again, increasing human population is going to put a huge demand on crop production. Now, at this point and from here on, we're going to use the word crop production, and it means at its most fundamental level, how much you can get out of a unit of land, because climate change is changing the amount of land available for agriculture, and we've already occupied somewhere between 30 and 50% of the agriculture land on the planet. So we have to learn how to do more on an individual plot of land. That's what every farmer wants. So increasing human population, meat and dairy consumption from growing affluence. People no longer want to get all their protein from cereal. But you could, and it costs about 100 times less in terms of water and nutrients and everything else. Actually, the ratio is more like 2,000 to 1 or something like that. It's an unbelievable number. And the number for water is even worse. Biofuel consumption. Once the farmers in here, in our country, got attuned to the idea that they could grow corn for biofuels, they switched over and began selling to people who were making biofuels out of corn. And the investment in that exercise controls food prices to a large degree now. The food riots that occurred in 2007 and again in 2011 were related to manipulation of the market by guys with really big money to invest in biofuel consumption. So biofuels are an important element in all of this. We have the idea that they can relieve us of doing fossil fuels, but they also take the land out of production for food. The estimate is that by 2050, global agricultural production may need to be increased 60 to 110%. To meet increasing demands, as well as to provide food security to the 870 million now chronically undernourished. So this is not a very good picture of the future. But as I said before, wait, there's more. The estimate of what we need into the future for this one is corn. The estimate of increase in production in the future is this line. This is the extended line for what we see we can produce. And that difference works out to be a lot by 2050. It's the same for these other crops. During the last half of the 20th century, production of corn increased at an average 2% per year. So by the end of the century, we were producing 100% more on the same amount of land than we were 50 years before that. But that has changed now for crops. Crop yields have begun to taper off. Here is the rice, the annual yield of rice per unit land area in China. This is from a review, photosynthetic efficiency of greater yield. I like that word right up there in the front. And I happen to know two of these guys, so they don't need the advertising, but there it is. In fact, one of them worked here for a while. They show that the increase in yield in China and rice increased up until about the year 2000, and then it's flattened out. And this is true for a number of crops. In fact, this group, Labelle and Field, have shown that there is a decline in crop production across this period of time from 1985 to into the 2000s of wheat, soy, barley, corn, and sorghum. And these declines are connected to changes in climate, or climate change. But I think the biggest one, the most stunning paper that I've read on this part of it was produced by a guy by the name of Schlenker at Columbia. He's an economist, an agriculture economist. And this is an example of what you can do with big data. By big data, I mean enormous quantities of information. So Schlenker and his group gathered up all of the information they could get out of each county in North America which raises these crops, corn, soybeans, and cotton. Now, counties keep track of the tax records, so they know pretty much what the yields were. They also keep track of the weather, so they had data on the temperature. And what these guys found out was that for all of these things, there is an abrupt drop in productivity after you go by about 90 degrees Fahrenheit. It's down here as about 30 degrees centigrade in that region. It's a little different for each one. Not much happens until you get to about the 30 degrees centigrade or about 90 degrees, but the rule of thumb is that the crop production, the yield of these crops drops off at the rate of about 10% per degree centigrade increase beyond 30 degrees. So consider the number of hours if your crop exists at 90 degrees here in the summertime. We hit 90 degrees a lot now. With that temperature alone will reduce the yield by that rule of thumb, 5 to 10% for Fahrenheit and about 10% for centigrade per degree increase. So if, did you have a question?
Is that exclusive of moisture?
Yes. And that's one of the interesting things is that there's been a lot of work on this to separate the effects of moisture, that is precipitation, from the effects of temperature. So temperature alone, rising temperature alone, is enough to challenge the productivity that we now have on Earth. Even if we reduce emissions by 50% by 2050 relative to 1991 levels, yields could still fall between 30 and 46%. If they fall at all, it's bad news because the projections are we need more by 2050 than we need now. Some say by 2050 we will need more food than we've ever produced before. This is an astounding number. It boggles the mind. This is what I've read. I don't know how they get there, but the people who study food production into the future say that the rising temperature and climate change, the redistribution of water on the earth, will have a big effect on crop production. That's what worries them. What can they do about it? Well, the plant physiologists and the crop physiologists say that in producing plants that grow really well and yield high in certain places over time, now they figured out how to pretty much match the variety of crop to the place where you live. And they do it very, very exactly. But what they are finding is that plants have carried along with them, along with all the traits that make them higher producers, a weaker response to stress. Stress is used to be very general. It can be low temperature in spring or too much temperature in the summertime, lack of water. It usually means response to drought or drying or a drying atmosphere. Drought may not be just lack of water, it may also be a very dry atmosphere. So the picture does not look very good. Now, I haven't mentioned anything about nitrogen. We had a few years ago, you can tell by the buildings, seminar here, and Pat McGonigal and I have been arguing ever since about what was really important. I say CO2, he says microbes rule, because microbes below ground pretty much regulate the amount of nitrogen that plants have available to them. So he says, of course, elements are earth, water, fire, and air, but what about nitrogen? Surely you can't ignore nitrogen. And so I want to tell you this story about how plants are regulating their nitrogen by high CO2. This line here in this graph is a measure of the number of stomates on a leaf of plants growing in these different CO2 levels. In fact, the purple was plants grown in very high CO2, and the blue was at normal ambient CO2. So just growing plants in high CO2 reduces the number of stomates on the leaves. And then if you raise the CO2 around that plant, you can affect the number of stomates there. Notice here down at low CO2, like there was during the Ice Age, it goes up very quickly. Sorry. Closing that valve reduces transpiration. And transpiration is a huge process. Some say that more water moves between plants and the atmosphere than the movement of any other process on Earth. Now, I don't know about tides moving the oceans, but I think they're really talking about comparing it with runoff on streams. So the amount of water delivered by plants, particularly trees, into the atmosphere is a very big number. So what happens when you reduce that by some substantial amount? And it does reduce evapotranspiration quite a bit. And here, I've plotted evapotranspiration, photosynthesis, and the ratio of the two, which is called water use efficiency. And up here is photosynthesis in normal CO2, and then in high CO2. It's different for these two. That's evapotranspiration. It's cut down some here. But photosynthesis at the same time is increasing. So these plants are doing more photosynthesis on less water. These guys are doing slightly more, but when you put the two together and make the ratio out of it, this is the water use efficiency. If you double the CO2, you double the water use efficiency. Now you can look at that a number of ways. You can either grow more crops on the same amount of water that you've got, or I forget what the other way was. But in any case, water use efficiency is a term used by plant guys, and it means from the plants. And the same term applies to the water use efficiency of a crop. And when it comes to crops, you lose about 2,000 tons of water to get a ton of yield of wheat. 2,000 to 1. Here is photosynthesis, and here is the ratio of the two. Experiments done over here at Beltsville by James Bunce show very clearly that if you manipulate evapotranspiration, that is, if you grow the plants in high CO2 so that they're losing less water, here's transpiration down here, and here's the total nitrogen uptake over here. These three lines are the same plants measured at different times. I don't know how many plants in each little block here, but the take-home lesson is that the numbers always line up on the line, and the plants grown in low CO2 lose more water and they take up more nitrogen. The plants growing in high CO2 lose less water and they take up less nitrogen. Now, this is not fully understood exactly how this works. The concept here is that you have a pipeline from the soil up to the leaves, and that pipeline somehow is inhibited by what's going on at the top. If you shut the valve down at the top so less water comes up, then less nitrogen comes up. We know we can do this experiment in a very short time. We take a plant and expose it first to normal CO2 and then to high CO2. If we label the nitrogen, we can see that we can basically reproduce the take-home lesson here in as little as 4 hours, and that's been done in our lab here. So what does this do? This less nitrogen produces less proteins in the plant. For potatoes, it's about 15% less. Here's wheat, rice, and barley. So it's somewhat variable. In fact, in our hands out here, it varies from minus 5% to minus 30%, an enormous range that seems to depend somewhat on availability of water. Soybeans don't show much effect because the fixation of nitrogen is internal within the plant. So this suggests that the whole problem is the barrier between, or right at the barrier between the root and the environment. I expect you'll see numerous dissertations in the near future where people are looking at this. This impact on wheat, for example, reduces all of the minerals and all of the proteins. And you can see here the atmospheric CO2 level. Here is the a measure of the proteins over here. And this shows the decline from low CO2 up to high CO2. What does this mean? Well, some say this increasing CO2 threatens human nutrition. This shows the same idea, the reduction in the proteins for all these different plants. The International Food, the IFPRI, whatever that means, I've forgotten that. It's in Washington. They have done a big study on the effect of climate change on food prices in the future. Future food prices are going to depend on increases in the economy for various amounts of CO2 you put up in the atmosphere. They always give a range because we don't know how high it's going. For maize, for rice, and for wheat, half of the increase in food prices in the future will be due to climate change. So we have forecasts that suggest the rates of production that we have now are not sufficient for the future. We have plant physiologists suggesting it's getting worse because as climate change goes up, there's a direct impact on crop yield. And we have these guys telling us, and we also have another plant physiologist telling you that the nitrogen concentration is going down, and so the nutrition is going to be challenged, and all of that's going to lead to increased food prices. The impacts here, in developing countries, climate change will cause yield declines for the most important crops. South Asia will be particularly hard hit. Calorie availability in 2050 will not only be lower than in the no climate change scenario, it will actually decline relative to 2000 levels throughout the developing world. CO2 is going up. How high, we're not sure, because we don't know enough about what's going on the land. And the temperature is going up. And that's basically it for this week. Next week, controlling CO2, and the week after that. The title of the lecture is something weird. I think it's Deniers, Uncertainty, Science. I don't know what the words I use in there. I'm terrible at titles. But there's a paper, Global Warming, How Skepticism Became Denial. I have that paper. It's by Spencer Wirt, good writer. Historian of science. If any of you happen to want that, if you'll email me, I'll email you a copy. I know Spencer would be happy to have you read it. And this book, this book is available online. And with that, I'll stop, and if you have any questions, I'll try to answer them. Thank you for your attention.